Sir, it is 6 o'clock. Can we start, sir?
Yeah, I am ready whenever you are.
All right, sir. Thank you. Good evening. A warm welcome to all of you to the webinar series hosted by Advocates Association Bengaluru. We have with us today Mr. S. Srivatsa, Senior Advocate, High Court of Karnataka. Sir, it's an honor to have you with us today. Welcome to the webinar.
Thank you. Thank you.
Now, I take the privilege of introducing our today's speaker. Mr. Srivatsa obtained his law degree from Jagatguru Renukacharya College of Law. He enrolled as an advocate in the year 1976 and joined the reputed law firm King and Partridge as an advocate. Initially, Mr. Srivatsa practiced predominantly in the trial courts and then moved to the high court. He has appeared in all courts from revenue courts till the Supreme Court of India. He is designated as a senior advocate by the High Court of Karnataka. He loves reading, listening to music, painting, writing, and playing golf. He is associated with various NGOs, including mentally retarded children and leprosy patients, amongst the others. He was the vice president of the Mayo Hall unit for 2 times. He was a nominated member for 2 times and a chairman for 1 time of the disciplinary committee of the Karnataka State Bar Courts. In the recent past, since the time pandemic has crept in, Mr. Srivatsa has used his spare time in contributing to the younger members of the bar by developing an app where his lectures on CPC is made accessible. Sir, once again, on behalf of Advocates Association Bengaluru, I extend a warm welcome to you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Good evening. At the outset, I would like to offer my grateful thanks to all my teachers, honorable judges, my seniors at the bar, and my colleagues at the bar who have over the years taught me a lot of law to make me what I am today. The topic for today's webinar is CPC, Execution of Decrees. Sections 36 to 74 and Order 21, Rule 1 to 106 are arguably the most important provisions in the CPC. What would happen if there was no provision for execution of a decree or an order? The rest of the CPC would become useless. Whether you got a decree after a trial, through arbitration, through mediation, or compromise, if there was no way to enforce it, all of that would become useless. The provisions of the CPC in so far as they relate to execution can be divided into 2 groups. The major rules are contained in sections 36 to 74. And as I would say, the minor rules are contained in Order 21, Rules 1 to 106. Now, a decree which is obtained can be executed by the court which passed the decree, or the court to which the decree has been transferred for execution. This is usually the place where the case started, the lowest in the hierarchy. As a matter of interest, the Supreme Court of India is not an executing court. And this was held so by the Supreme Court in Citibank versus Standard Chartered Bank, a decision reported in 2004, Volume 8, SCC 348. 2004, 8 SCC 348. The decree can be executed when the decree holder asking for execution. It may be oral or in writing. In this webinar, I will confine myself to those applications which are made in writing. There is no specific format for filing an execution petition. Provided it can be in any format, provided all the relevant details are contained therein. Now, once I file an application for execution in the court, which passed the decree, 2 situations arise. The court which passed the decree, can it execute it? It can execute it if the JDR lives within his jurisdiction. It can arrest the JDR. But the JDR has property outside the jurisdiction of the court, which can be attached and sold or delivered depending on the decree it is. And then it can transfer that if you want any attachment of the property. Now, if the defendant does not reside in Bangalore but resides, say, in Chennai, resides in Gulbarga, wherever, outside the jurisdiction of the city civil court, it can transfer the decree to Chennai or to such other place. Now, this transfer is done by the executing court, either of its own accord or on an application made by the DHR. The transferor court sends it to some other court, and that court becomes the executing court. The transferee court, that is the court to which the decree is sent, has all the powers of the court which passed the decree. And once the decree is transferred, it becomes, the transferee court becomes the executing court. But there is one thing to remember, but by transferring a decree, the transferor court does not lose jurisdiction. Sections 37 to 43 of the Code of Civil Procedure nowhere lays down that after a decreeing court transfers a decree, it loses its jurisdiction by the mere act of transfer. It does not deprive itself of jurisdiction. A very useful and illuminating decision I have, it's a very old judgment, maybe you can read it, Fateh Chand versus Jeetmal, 1920, ILR 1929, Bombay 844. Very nicely discussed by the judges. Now there is one other situation. Supposing the decree, the judgment debtor has owes me 1 crore of rupees. He has a property in Bangalore worth about 25 lakhs, which is not enough to satisfy my decree. He has got a property in Chennai worth about 75 lakhs. With both of them, I can recover my money. Now, the question is, how do I go about it? The question is, I should file simultaneous execution of the same decree. There is nothing in the CPC which says that the same decree cannot be executed simultaneously, that is at the same time. I can file an execution at Bangalore, have the decree also transferred to Chennai, and at the same time have the same decree executed at Chennai. Now, the Supreme Court in Premlata Agarwal versus Lakshman Prasad Gupta, 1970 volume 3 SCC 440, 1973 SCC 440 has said that simultaneous execution is possible, but it should be used sparingly by the court in exceptional cases by imposing proper terms so that hardship is not caused to the judgment debtor by allowing several attachments to be proceeded with at the same time, or to harass the judgment debtor by filing executions in various places. Now, this is a vast subject, execution, so I have formulated what I believe are important questions which to which answers I may have to give. I may have formulated 10 questions which I will answer. I will also answer any questions if I can at the end of the webinar. Question number one, what is the executing court? The court which passed the decree is the executing court. Now, let us take a situation where a decree is appealed against and is confirmed by the High Court, say, in a regular first appeal in Karnataka, Bangalore city. The court which passed the decree is the city civil court. In this case, the city civil court is the executing court for the reason that though the High Court confirmed it and the decree of the civil court merged with that of the High Court, the executing court is still the city civil court. Now, for those of you, Mr. Rangarajan will remember way back in 1980 when the City Civil Court Act came into force. I think it was 5th of July 1980 or 81. The only place in the order sheet of any court in any case written in green ink, I think on the orders of Justice M.N. Venkatachale, as he then was, it was then there is somewhere along the way it happened. Now, supposing there is a decree passed by the principal district judge, Bangalore. We didn't have Bangalore Urban, Bangalore City, District Judge, Bangalore Urban. It goes up in RFA, RFA confirms it. The day after RFA is confirmed by the High Court, the City Civil Court Act comes into force. The Principal District Judge, Bangalore City is replaced by the Principal City Civil Judge, Bangalore City. The court which passed the decree does not exist. It is replaced by the City Civil Court. Then which is the executing court? The law says that the court which has jurisdiction to try the suit in which the decree was passed at the time of filing the execution petition will be the executing. Now, the next situation is City Civil Court passes a decree. Then Bangalore city is divided into Bangalore urban district and Bangalore rural district. So you have a principal city civil and sessions, city civil and sessions judge. You have a principal district and sessions judge for Bangalore rural. City Civil Court passes the decree. That area comes within the jurisdiction of the principal district and sessions judge Bangalore rural. Then which is the executing court? The answer is the court which at the time the execution is filed has jurisdiction to try the suit in which the decree was passed will be the executing court. So this, I how the executing court. Question number two. Can property of a judgment debtor in jurisdiction of another court be attached without transfer of a decree? In my view, the answer is yes. Section 46 of the Code of Civil Procedure provides that this can be done by applying to the court which passed the decree to issue a precept to the court within whose jurisdiction the property is there and which can execute the decree. On an application for precept being made, the court which passed the decree will issue a precept to the other court requiring that a certain property be attached, and the court to which it is sent will attach that property. But there is one thing you have to remember when you have an order for a precept. A precept has a lifespan of 2 months. At the end of 2 months, the precept spends itself unless the precept is extended. Now, the main object appears to be that I have a decree, the judgment debtor is in Chennai, is about to sell the property. By the time I make a petition, get an order of transfer, take it by muddam or by hand to Madras, to the subordinate court at Madras, process it in the office and get it to come up before the court for further orders, the property might be sold. Now, therefore, the concept of precept is there. Usually, precept is used by us on the original side. Now, this precept can be used in the execution or on the original side. When we get an order for attachment of before judgment under Order 38, Rule 5, then what happens is we need to attach property. There is nothing in the code which says that attachment before judgment cannot be done of properties outside the jurisdiction of the court which passes the order. Now, how do I communicate this? Virtually, how do I communicate this? So once I get an order of attachment under 38.5, I tell the court, please issue a precept to, say, the subordinate judge at Hosur. The man has got some factory premises there, I want to attach it. Court issues a precept, I take it to Hosur and attach it. The court to which the precept is sent cannot go beyond what is it is instructed by the court issuing the precept. Now, there is a judgment. These are all judgments not of this court. One is AR 1961 Andhra Pradesh 417. And the other is 2009 Volume 6 CTC 382 of the Madras High Court. Now, as far as the requirement, consequences of issue of a precept, these are in detailed discussion. You can find in 1969 Volume 2 Andhra Pradesh Law Journal 415. Now, in one case, what happened years ago? This is a very, very old case where a precept was issued. 2 months passed. Before the expiry of 2 months, the decree holder made an application for extension of the period of the precept, because or else it will die out in 2 months. The court, by reason of pressure of work or for some other reason, did not pass an order before the expiry of 2 months. It was contended that no, the precept is over. They could not have extended it. The Madras High Court took a view that the delay of the court in passing an order cannot be allowed to prejudice the decree holder, that is the person asking for a precept. And when the court passed an order after the expiry of 2 months, the Madras High Court said it should be given retrospective effect from the date on which it expires. Very old judgment, AR 1918 Madras 1262. This still is good law. I have not found any judgment which has overruled this either expressly or by implication. And this seems to be the correct law. Because the basic law is that any no act of the court should harm some party. General principle. It seems to have been applied in this case. Next, we come to question 3. I have a decree. I have transferred it to Chennai. What is the power of the transferee court? You will find the powers of the transferee court in section 42 of the CPC. It has the same power as the court which passed the decree. It has the power to punish for obstructing or delaying the execution of a decree. It has the power to send the decree to a court subordinate, the words used are subordinate to it for execution, to execute the decree against the legal representatives of the JDR, and it has power to attach a decree. Now, as regards the powers of the transferee court, there are two judgments of our High Court, that is the Karnataka High Court. The power reference can be made to ILR 2013 Karnataka 4266. ILR 2013 Karnataka 4266, which deals with the scope of powers of the transferee court. Then, in another judgment, the Karnataka High Court held, I read the footnote somewhere, it held that the transferee court has more powers than the transferor court. That was in ILR 1985 Karnataka 2420. I went through the judgment. In that case, what happened was the civil judge had passed the order. It was transferred to the court of the Munsif. And there Justice Kulkarni had discussed that the transferee court has the same power as the transferor court. In that connection, it was said that the transferee court has got more powers than the transferor court. That is how that judgment came to be written that way. Now, I also told you that the transferee court has power to attach a decree. Now, in one case, what happened was, I had a decree. I assigned it to another person. That other person, and the decree is transferred to Chennai. That person goes to Chennai, the transferee court, and tells the court, listen, I need your approval that the decree has been assigned to me. This is it. There the Madras High Court said that where you are making an application for approval of an assignment of a decree, you cannot make it in the transferee court. You will have to make it in the court which passed the decree. This is found in 1998 3 Law Weekly 116 Madras or 1977 Supreme Court Online Madras 702. 1977 Supreme Court Cases Online Madras 702. Now, in one more case, what happened? A decree was passed, defendant remained, the case proceeded ex parte, decree was passed, decree holder filed execution, got it transferred to Chennai. The defendant then went to Chennai and made an application under Order 9 Rule 13 saying, set aside the ex parte decree. It was held that the transferee court does not have power to set aside the ex parte decree. You have to go back to the court which passed the decree. This is found in 1978 SEC Online, Andhra Pradesh, page 89. Then we have Order 21, Rule 50, which deals with execution against partnership firms. The Punjab and Haryana High Court held that whether the decree was executable against certain persons or not, on an application made under Order 21, Rule 50, Subrule 2, could be filed and decided by the transferee court. So this is as far as the transferee court and its powers. I've given you a few cases, a wide spectrum of cases. There are hundreds of cases which, depending on the situation you're faced, of what the transferee court can do and cannot do. Lawyers come up with ingenious arguments. Judges come up with decisions. And we have a lot of case law. Question number 4. This is a very important question. what are the questions which can be determined by the executing court? Section 47. This section invariably causes a lot of confusion amongst lawyers. The Supreme Court has said that Section 42 gives the court to which a decree is sent for execution the same powers in executing the decree as though it had been passed by itself. Now, whether it is the court which passed the decree or the transferee court, the executing court has a duty to see that the decree holder gets what has been given to him by the decree. Now, supposing there is a dispute as to what is the identity of or the substance of what has been given to the decree holder, then the court can examine it under Section 47. There are basically five areas in which the executing court, either the court which passed the decree or the transferee court, can take a decision. These powers are provided by Section 47. One, any matter relating to execution taken out by the decree holder, which is again circumscribed by judicial opinion. Any matter relating to the discharge of a decree, any matter relating to the satisfaction of a decree, the question whether any person or persons is or is not the legal representatives of the JDR, any matter relating to possession of the delivery of possession of the property, and in all these matters, no separate suit is maintainable. Section 47 is important and it is necessary for it to be understood if we are to apply this section usefully in our daily practice. Now, I have tried to think of what we should know about Section 47. I think there are about 11 or 12 points which come to my mind. One, the power under Section 47 for the executing court is narrower than the power of appeal, review, or revision. Section 47 is not an alternative to an appeal. Section 47 lies within a narrow compass. There is some amount of restriction placed on 47 by Order 21, Rule 2, and to some extent Rule 3. The provisions of 21, Rule 2 have been enacted to prevent unscrupulous judgment debtors from setting up false claims, cooked up pleas, so long as to prolong the execution. Now, under 47, the court can consider whether the decree which is sought to be executed is void ab initio and a nullity, or otherwise is inexecutable, or if it was passed in ignorance of some law. There are three judgments of the Supreme Court which explain various aspects of this same proposition. 1994, 4SCC 370. I repeat, 1994, 4SCC 370. 1976, 2SCC 144. 1976, 2SCC 134. 2002, 9SCC 28. Now, the 1976 judgment of the Supreme Court was a case where a decree was superseded. The decree was negated by a statute. Then the court said that question can be gone into under 47. Now, what is a reasonably good rule to follow to decide whether the decree suffers from a mere irregularity or a nullity? If a party who raises the objection can waive the irregularity, it is just an irregularity. If the party raising the objection cannot waive his objections, then it is a nullity. AR 1964 Supreme Court 1300. AR 1964 Supreme Court 1300. Section 47 is available only to the parties to the suit and to nobody else. The purchaser of property in execution is also treated as a party for the purposes of Section 47. Now, though we all say that the executing court cannot go behind the decree, it is possible under, because as I said, the Supreme Court said that the decree holder should get what he has been given. So the court cannot go behind the decree, but it can definitely go into the plaint. I'm sorry. The court can definitely go into the plaint and the discussion in the judgment to ascertain the true import of the decree, so that it can give the decree holder what he should get. AR 1972 Supreme Court 137. 72 Supreme Court 1. I'm sorry, 1371, not 137. 1371. Now under 47, you cannot go to the court and file an objection that the decree is incorrect in law or in fact. Not permissible under 47. AR 1970 Supreme Court 1475. Now supposing JDR dies, three people come say we are all legal representatives. Who is the legal representative can be decided by the court under section 47. Now supposing there's a situation where there's a decree but the JDR is in possession of the property. By the time the decree comes to execution, attachment, it takes some time. The property is not looked after. There is waste, deterioration. The extent of waste can be determined by the court under section 47. An old judgment, AR 1945 Madras 179. AR 1945 Madras 179. Now, when an application under 47 is made, the court can decide the application. But it also has the power, if it finds merit in it, to frame issues and to ask the parties to lead evidence. Now you can't go under 47 and say no, the suit was barred by limitation. That is not permissible. And all issues which come within the ambit of 47 have to be decided in 47 and not by a separate suit. Even recently, 2009, 9th volume SCC 28, 2009, 9 SCC 28, the Supreme Court says this is the position of law. Now there is one interesting judgment which the Supreme Court has passed. Now all of us know that when it comes under 47, you cannot maintain a separate suit. But in one case, Nandaram Mazumdar versus Indian Airlines, 1983, 4 SCC 461, the Supreme Court said, yes, you can't file a separate suit. You have to make an application under 47. But listen, I think it's in the interest of justice that the suit be treated as an application under section 47 and the matter be decided. Ultimately, procedure is handmaiden to justice. Supreme Court possibly looked at it that way and permitted it. Now, supposing there are more decree holders than one, there are two or three decree holders. They get a decree, they're together, then there's a fight. All three of them are fighting. An application under section 47 is not maintainable to decide who is to execute the decree. Because if you look at order 21 rule 15, it provides that the joint decree holders have to execute the decree in its entirety. It can't say that, I'm entitled, you're entitled, I'm entitled to execute a bit. So therefore, when there is a dispute between joint decree holders, an application under 47 is not maintainable to decide who will execute the decree. 1999, third volume SCC 644. 1999, 3 SCC 644. Now I can't come to the executing court and file an application under 47 and say the decree was obtained by collusion and therefore it's not maintainable. Such an application cannot be made under 47. AR 1955 Supreme Court 376. AR 1955 Supreme Court 376. Now I can't also come to the court under 47 and say, the trial court did not have territorial jurisdiction to pass the decree. So decree is not executed. Not permissible. 2019 volume 3 SCC 594. 2019 3 SCC 594. However, whether a decree has been discharged, whether a decree has been satisfied, are matters which can be decided under section 47. 2018, volume 18 SCC 165. 2018 SCC 165. Now we come to question 5, which I feel is very important, and sometimes I wonder why we don't make use of it. There is nothing in the Code of Civil Procedure which seems to say that unless I attach a property, I can sell it. If I have a decree and I don't want attachment and I want to sell the property, is it permissible? Section 51B of the CPC provides that the court may, on an application by the decree holder, order execution of a decree by sale of a property without attaching it. Now, we also have, then there is people who generally do execution will also say, what about Order 21 Rule 30? What about Order 21 Rule 54? What about Order 21 Rule 90, material irregularity? No. There is nothing in these provisions which will affect 51. The reason, to my mind, why a court has been given power to sell without attachment, because attachment by itself does not create any lien or charge on the property attached. The attaching creditors don't get title to the property just because they attach the property. All that happens is that when you attach a property, it is kept in custodial aegis. The person whose property is attached cannot sell it. Under 64, if you sell it when there is an attachment pending, the sale is void. So nothing can happen. There need not be attachment. There may be a decree holder who says, listen, I am prepared to take the chance, bring the property to sale. I found one judgment, an old judgment, AR 1939 Bombay 277. If anyone has a later judgment, please do let me know. I would like to learn. In this judgment, what happened was the property was sold without attachment. The sale was challenged, saying that there was irregularity because the property is not attached. The Bombay High Court said that there is no irregularity. Bombay High Court held that the effect of Order 21, Rules 30, 54, 90 was not to limit the power given under 51. These provisions do not take away the power given to the court to sell without attachment under Section 51B. The next question is execution of a decree against legal representatives. Is it possible that after the decree is passed, before execution is filed, the judgment debtor dies? Then the decree holder brings the legal representatives and says they have come into the estate of the deceased, executed. It is possible that execution is filed. During the continuance of execution proceedings, the JDR dies. Legal representatives can be brought on record. If I'm not mistaken, there's a judgment of Justice Kulkarni of our High Court saying that no formal application under 22 or anything is necessary. You can bring the LRs on record, possibly by filing a memo and saying these are the LRs of the deceased. And if they say that they are not the LRs, that there's a dispute, any of 47 is there. Now, where the property sought to be attached is ancestral property in the hands of the LRs. To the extent of their obligation under personal law, that is pious obligation, it can be attached. Where the legal representative gets property by inheritance, then to the extent of his inheritance, there may not be any personal liability of the legal representative. Now, in this process, sections 52, 50, 52, and 53 are important. They cover this position of execution against legal representatives. The court can compel the legal representatives to disclose the details of inheritance. What have you done with the property? What are your accounts? And all information which it may require so that an appropriate order can be made in execution. Now, this is about legal representatives. Then we come to the Now, in one more, by the passing, I also should say that we have section 94, which deals with supplemental proceedings. Supplemental proceedings are supplementary to the main provisions in the CPC and not incidental to them. They are not a means to an end. So the courts have circumscribed the jurisdiction of courts, civil courts, as far as section 94 is concerned. Maybe when the court asks for details from the legal representatives, something which is there, which is not covered by sections 50, 53, 52 and 53 could be asked under section 94, a supplemental proceeding, supplemental to the power of the court. Question number 7. How do I attach properties? Now, there are two kinds of properties, immovable property, movable property. Section 60 to 64 and Order 21, Rule 41 to 57 deal with attachment of property. If you read Section 60, you will see that it contains a long list of properties which can be attached and another list of properties which cannot be attached. We needn't go into that. Everybody, depending on their case, can go and check out the list and see whether the property sought to be attached falls within any of those categories or not. Now, properties which cannot be attached, is it open to the judgment debtor to waive that right? This matter has been decided by the Supreme Court in 1976, 3 SEC 607. 1976, 3 SEC 607. Now, this is not a matter which deals directly with what we are discussing. So, I just gave you this judgment so that those of you who are interested can read it and see. Now, 2154 seems to be the starting point. It provides for the mode or procedure for attachment of immovable property. It starts with issuing a prohibitory order to the JDR and to the general public. This order will stop the JDR from alienating the property. The court then sends a notice. I think Order 21, Rule 54, Subrule 1, Capital A, where it tells him, you come on a particular date. On that day, we will fix the date for issuing a proclamation for sale. Now, normally when a prohibitory order is passed, two copies are made. But when it relates to land in which revenue is paid, they make three copies. Now, in order to make the attachment valid, why I'm saying this is important is, we have one security guard sitting, Order 21, Rule 90, which says if there's a material irregularity, fraud in the conduct of the proceedings, the whole sale gets invalid. We have to be careful. In order to make the attachment valid, the details given in the schedule attached to the order should be matched with the details given in the warrant. There should be no discrepancy. We should be very careful. Now this goes to the bailiff, the nazir. He will take the warrant, do whatever he has to do, and endorse it and give it back. Now, olden days, there was beating of tom-tom, beating of drum, a fixture, whatever it is, and also a copy of this order will be affixed on the property of the JDR. Now, supposing if it is harvested crop, they'll put it on the cut corn. That also is permissible. The judgments say that is permissible. Now, once it is done, the bailiff will come back and give a note saying that all the required formalities have been completed. The presiding officer, especially at this stage, which is crucial, should make sure that all the procedures are completed correctly. Because as I said, there is a security guard. 21 Rule 90, material irregularity. That becomes one of the grounds to set aside this whole sale. It will cause serious trouble and loss to the JDR if he is not careful. Courts also should be careful, but then ultimately courts are under heavy pressure of work. Office is under pressure of work. The lawyer should make sure that these things are kept in order. Now, once I decide to go by the attachment route, not 51B, attachment route, then First, the property has to be attached. The order of attachment has to be issued. And all this has to be done in the manner prescribed by the rules. And then, in that order, there should be a prohibition to the JDR from selling the property. That's a very old judgment again, which still remains good law. They say the formalities required are mandatory because the intention is to prevent the JDR from transferring or alienating the property. KR 1928 Privy Council 139, Muthappa Chettiar versus Palaniappa Chettiar. AR 1928 Privy Council 139. Now, as far as agricultural lands are concerned, supposing Order 21 Rule 54 says if it's agricultural lands, I should take a copy of that order and give it to the Deputy Commissioner's office, post it there. It has been held by the Gujarat High Court that if this is not done, it is not a material irregularity. The reason given by the Gujarat High Court is there is no need of attachment before you sell the property. Once it goes to the Deputy Commissioner, automatically it goes out of the hands of everybody else. That is the view taken. This is as far as attachment of immovable properties are concerned. Order 21, Rule 41, 43, 44, 45 deals with movable properties. 41, money decree. 43A is movable property, not agricultural lands. Then if the property B is of perishable nature, what is to be done? And what is the liability of the custodian of such property? Now, where property attached is agricultural produce, movable produce. Rule 44 says, now how do I serve the copy of the attachment order? It can be affixed on the land on which the crop is grown, or where the produce is cut and gathered, or on the threshing floor, or on the fodder stack. That becomes the place where I can affix the attachment order. Then we come to 2145. It casts some sort of a duty on the judgment debtor to take necessary steps for preserving the property. If the JDR just leaves the crop as it is without taking steps to preserve it, the decree holder can take steps and recover the cost from the JDR. This is as far as movable property is concerned. Question 7. Garnishee proceedings. What are these garnishee proceedings? Section 46, I mean Rule 46, Rule 46A to 46I deals with garnishee proceedings. A garnishee is basically a judgment debtor's debtor. Now, supposing the attachment of a debt. Now, I have a decree against B. B is owed money by a company C. The debt is not secured by, my debt is not secured by a negotiable instrument. The attachment is made by telling the JDR, listen, you cannot take the money from C. Similarly, an order is given to C saying that, listen, you cannot pay the money to the judgment debtor. This is in AR 1961 Madras 189. Now, garnishee proceedings can be taken only in respect of property which can be attached under Section 60. If the property comes within the prohibited items under Section 60, you cannot take out garnishee proceedings. AR 1972 Andhra Pradesh, page 70. Now it is also possible that C will come to the court and say, listen, I don't owe any money to the JDR. Why are you sending me a notice? When he raises such an objection, the court must raise an issue and determine the liability of the garnishee. Now, where there are shares, you want to attach some shares in the company. The owner of the share will be prohibited from transferring the share or receiving any dividend. The company will be told, listen, if he makes an application for transfer, you cannot transfer. You cannot transfer, transmit, or permit him to sell or take over the shares and sell it as per the articles of association. Sometimes when calls are not paid, the forfeits the shares and takes away the money, all that, nothing can be done. So what happens next? Where the movable property is not within the, in the custody of the JDR. If it is in the custody of the court or with somebody else, the person in possession of the property will be ordered not to part with it to the JDR except with the orders of the court. Then 48, rule 48 is attachment of salaries of government employees, railway servants. When you send an order of attachment, the attachment is done by the department by withholding their salaries. Now, partnership property, 21 rule 50. You can't attach partnership property unless you have a decree against the partnership firm. If you have a decree only against the partnership firm, you cannot attach the properties of the partners unless they have been made parties in the suit itself. So once you, unless these two conditions are there, part, though they say liability of the partners is joint and several and all that, they're agents of the partnership firm. For the CPC, if there is a decree against the partnership firm, partners are not parties in the original suit, you cannot enforce anything against them. If you make them parties, then you can enforce them to whatever extent you want. You can proceed against any one person who is the richest of them, and they can then decide to compensate each other. Next, we have seen attachment of movable and movable properties. Now, how do you do sale? Sale, the court starts with attaching the property and giving notice to the JDR, order 21, rule 54, 55, 56, 57. They also deal with attachment, how to remove attachment, pay the money, whatever it is. Now, when the court gives notice to the JDR to attend the court on a specified date, subsequently for fixing the proclamation, subsequent notice under 2168 is 66 is not necessary. This is just keep it in mind because we'll come to that. Then court under order 21, rule 58 adjudicates claims or objections to the attachment with power under rule 59 to stay the same. Orders 21, rule 64 to 68 deal with the sale itself. Now, the 64 is a very crucial section. It casts an obligation, a duty on the court. Supposing I have a property, JDR is a property worth 1 crore. Decree holder gets a decree for 25 lakhs. Now, if they sell the entire property, the judgment debtor would unnecessarily be prejudiced. So the court has a duty first to see whether the sale of the entire property is necessary or whether sale of a portion of the property can be done. Is it possible? For example, there is a house with 3 shops. 3 shops when sold would get 25 lakhs. The court can say, okay, the decree will be executed only against the 3 shops which will be sold and not against the house. This is a mandatory obligation on the part of the executing court before it goes in for sale. Failure to do that, the Supreme Court says, renders, vitiates the sale transaction itself. Now, 64 adre, 68 ik barthi. 68 is for proclamation. Now the proclamation should be made in form 29 of Appendix E, CPC. It should be in the language of the court, Karnataka dali Kannada. Notice of this proclamation should be given to the JDR. But if the JDR has already received notice under 2154-1A, fresh notice need not be given to him under this provision. Also in the form, I've seen in some books, the last column value of the property as stated by the JDR is one of the essential conditions in many forms, even in our city civil court at Bangalore. In some forms, I've seen that last column is missing. Absence of the last column may be a material irregularity. It depends on how the lawyer puts it across under 2190. Once proclamation is issued, it has to be affixed on the court premises. Once it is affixed on the court premises, Alinda, from there, for removable property, 30 days have to pass before you can sell. In the case of movable property, 15 days have to pass when you can sell the property. Next question is question 9, is when can a sale be set aside? Order 21, Rule 89, 90, 91 provide for this. Now, Order 21, Rule 89 says that any person having an interest after the sale is done should deposit 5% of the value, should also take approval of the court to pay the balance of the sale consideration. But this application has to be made within 60 days from the date of sale. Invariably, the client will come to you after 3 months, after having tried to see what all can be done, nothing is possible, they'll come and say, sir, property sold, do something. Then you will go through 89 and say, listen, boss, 60 days are over, you can't do it. 92, no, 60 days is there, you can't do anything. So invariably, what do? Invariably, the route taken is Order 21, Rule 90. Order 21, Rule 90 says sale can be set aside without deposit. There's no deposit, there's no time limit. It's very useful to us. What we have to do, there is irregularity or fraud in publishing and conducting the sale. So sale conducting starts with attachment under 2154 proclamation in the Ella Bandhu proportionality note count 64 and you come to sale. So 2190 would be a provision to set aside a sale without deposit of money, provided you can prove that there was material irregularity in or fraud in publishing and conducting the sale. And also we have to show that the person has suffered substantial injury, not irreparable injury, substantial injury, maybe a little more than just injury, substantial injury. Now under 91, sale after purchase, the purchaser can come forward and say, listen, the JDR did not have title to the property to convey. The sale can be set aside. This aspect, then we come to normally what happens. Order 21, when there is obstruction. Order 21, Rule 97 to 106. Basically, it's Order 21. Now, Order 21, Rule 97. The sections, the rules are not placed in order. So, when there is obstruction, Order 21, Rule 97, the application, there will be an inquiry under 101. There will be an order under 98. I think I'm correct, 98. Then, just a minute. Yes, rule not 98. 97 Arji Adre, 101 it will be the determination, 98 will be the order. Now what happens is where a person other than the JDR is dispossessed, then he makes an application under 99. 101 will be, 101 is the adjudicating provision where the court adjudicates everything. And an order will be passed in terms of Rule 100. 2197, 101, 98. 2199, 101, 100. Now supposing, this is the sequence of events. Previous, and if you read 97, resistance or obstruction, it appears as though only the decree holder can do it, but judicial opinion has said that anybody who is there and who claims to be in possession in his own right can maintain an application under 97. He need not wait till he is dispossessed and then come under 2199. He can stop it at 97 stage. 102 says, where somebody has bought the property pending litigation. Because if you look at the list pendants under the TP Act, it says from the institution of the suit till final completion of the execution, list pendants continues. So that is reflected here in 102. So 98 and 100 will not apply. Nobody is entitled if you have a list pendants purchase. 103 says that when an order is passed under rule 98, that is 97 and lakh order under 98, 99 under 100, when it is passed like that, it amounts to a decree. And this will become subject matter of an appeal. Now what happens in a situation where the person who is sitting in the property has already filed a suit, say for possession. If it's under 99, filed a suit for possession. The court passes an order rejecting his application. The order under 100 and 100 will be subject to the result of the suit, which is already pending when such order was passed. I'm not very sure as to why these provisions are like this. They seem to be mutually conflicting. Possibly there is a reason. Now, 106 is setting aside the ex parte order. Now, my dear friends, execution in colleges is given as a full semester curriculum, 90 hours. We are trying to complete it in 1 hour. I have given you some judgments. These judgments, I believe, will help you understand the provisions, and the mystery surrounding execution will disappear. It is necessary, after seeing this, to go back and read more, because there are so many facts and circumstances, factual situations change, where and different judgments are there. I also thought, maybe if the organizers want it, I can give them a copy of my notes, about 25 pages which I have done. I will pass it on to them, and anybody who wants to see it can please go to it. After all, I believe that in this adversarial system, the one thing which is very clear, that you never lose a case. If you lose a case, you still learn. You only win or you learn. Nothing else happens. So I'm sure that the organizers will permit me. I will send them a copy by mail and they can pass it on to whomsoever requires it. Maybe the notes read at leisure may offer more clarity than my own speaking. I'm ready to take any questions now.
Thank you, sir, for a very informative session and very kind of you to share the notes. In fact, we have been getting a lot of requests and feedback to take the literature from the concerned speaker, but we have our own plans and we have just deferred it for the moment. But however, it would be great if you could share it with us at a later point of time, sir.
I will.
Can we now move on to the Q&A session, sir?
Yes.
All right. Can we have the first question online, please? Can we have the first online question? All right. We will start up with the offline question. Mr. Kumar has a question, sir. If parties to the suit obtain decree concealing necessary parties, what would be the remedy of aggrieved party, whether he has to file application under section 47 or prefer appeal to appellate court?
When a suit is bad for non-joinder of necessary parties, that is a matter which has to be decided in appeal. Because when you come to the, it is not a matter for execution of the decree. The decree is between A and B. Whether C and D should also have been parties is not a question which will be gone into by the executing court.
Okay. Can we have the next online question, please? Mr. Murthy Nayak has a question. Yes, sir, you are unmuted. Please go ahead with your question.
Sir, good evening.
Good evening.
Sir, I had a very simple question. Can an application for arrest and attachment be filed simultaneously?
If you are maintaining an application for attachment and there is property of the judgment debtor available for attachment, then how do you ask? Arrest can be granted when you say that during the pendency of the suit, he has secreted, concealed, or removed the property, or he is trying to run away from the jurisdiction of the court, or dishonest motive, trying to delay or obstruct a decree. Just because a man is poor, you cannot get him arrested. You have asked for attachment. You have to take it, wait for him to earn some more money and go back. After all, a decree is valid for 12 years and there is no res judicata. You can file as many applications for execution as possible. I don't think the court will permit arrest and attachment at the same time because the ingredients will not match.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. We have one offline question by Mr. Kumar.
Yeah.
The judgment and decree obtained by a vendor for eviction of tenant, can I execute the decree being assignee against same tenant after I purchased the premises?
Now, that would be a question whether the judgment and decree was passed under the Rent Act, in which case bona fide use and occupation, etc., would have been considered, and an assignee would not be step into the shoes of the decree holder. Whereas if it is any other person, if there is an assignment of the decree and there is a decree like under the 106, I see no reason why if the assignment is held valid, the decree cannot be executed.
Absolutely, sir. Thank you, sir. Can we have Mr. Naresh is raising his hand. Yes, sir. You are unmuted.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I have a question.
Yes.
In a suit, there is a mistake. By mistake, the schedule was tabled erroneously. Schedule. But in the execution court, can it be rectified by filling an amendment application under Order 6 with 17?
You will have to go back to the original suit, have the mistake rectified there, and thereafter come the executing court. Now, if it rectifies your in the executing court, that means it's changing the decree itself. The decree asked, you said, I'll get you plum cake for in the decree. Now you're asking for chocolate cake. It's not going to happen. You have to
it
go back to the original court.
It has so happened, and a decree passed in 1976. It was amended in 2016 in an execution court.
Maybe you can challenge it. I don't know.
Thank you.
We have Mr. Rahul Chakravarti who has a question. Mr. Rahul, go ahead with your question.
Good afternoon, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I am a final year law student. I have one question. During your lecture, you mentioned that when they are attaching the crop, they can take the measures to prevent the crop from deteriorating.
That is the JDR. The person who owns the crop should take measures. If he does not take measures, the decree holder can take measures and then give a list of the expenses to the executing court and recover the money from the JDR.
Okay, that was my question, sir. Who is going to bear the cost?
No. Ultimately, JDR has to bear. That's it. Yes, sir.
Now we have Mr. Harish. Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir. Regarding execution of foreign decrees in India,
yes.
Which period of limitation will be applied, needs to be applied, whether the issuing foreign court's limitation period or the execution
I think courts. When there is a foreign decree, again after the foreign decree, first they will try to execute it there. It may be executed in a bit portion. Then go to section, I think, 44. Alinda certificate tagombandu, even if you come and file it in the executing court, you can execute the decree, and here the decree, now the executing court has the powers of the court which passed the decree. Therefore, Limitation Act here will apply for you to execute 12 years from the date of decree.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have Mr. Jitendra. Yes, please go ahead, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
In a partition suit, the final decree should be drawn on stamp paper.
Yes,
but in one case, the court not drawn the final decree on the stamp paper. In that case, court commissioner has submitted his report, and a petitioner has submitted that he has received the his part as per the commission report, and the case was closed. No final decree is drawn. and on the basis of the commission report and the and that order, the petitioner got changed in the khata. I want to
hello
ask what is the validity of the order and the passing of the
khata. Very honestly, that is not a question relating to execution of a decree. Even according to you, no final decree is passed. That would come under some other provision where a final decree is not drawn up. If it is transferred, then the transfer of khata should possibly be challenged, or maybe you should ask the court, reopen the final decree proceedings and ask the court to pass a decree. Apparently, your people may not have paid the 1,000 rupees court fee. Because in a partition suit, all plaintiffs are defendant, all defendants are plaintiff, everybody pays the court fee and get decree in their name. Maybe that is not an Madi Radila. That is why it has happened.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Vijay Kumar, yes.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, a suit for injunction in respect of agriculture land was decreed. Subsequent to decree, sir, the defendant has come and interfered again. Whether that can be executed in execution proceedings?
Yes, Order 21, Rule 32 deals with execution for in respect of restitution of conjugal rights, decrees for injunction. Just see Order 21, Rule 33, that is by arrest or by attachment.
Sir,
32.
There is a inquiry is necessary in the 21, Rule 32. Suppose if we interfered after subsequent to decree, how to execute the decree, sir?
Then if he has interfered, then you say that he has interfered, file an affidavit, which the court feels necessary, the court has power to record evidence and pass an order.
Okay, sir.
Right. 2132 is important. That is okay. The provision for you.
Okay.
Sakila has a question. Sakila, you have to unmute. Quickly. Meanwhile, we'll take up one offline question. So there are a couple of questions offline.
Yep.
Whether the bailiff has got any right to demarcate the property and deliver possession without any order from the court?
No. First of all, the bailiff is not a court commissioner. The bailiff gives to the decree holder what is ordered by the court. If a demarcated portion is not ordered by the court, the bailiff cannot take over the role of the executing court to demarcate and give. It's virtually saying bailiff can put a house number and deliver possession of a property saying that this is house number. Barodil, not possible.
All right, sir. Thank you. We have Mr. Ravishankar. Can you throw light on verified statements that needs to be filed before bringing the property for sale?
I didn't understand the question.
I would repeat it, sir. Can you throw light on verified statements that needs to be filed before bringing the property for sale?
Before bringing the property for sale, you have to make the application to the court where you will say that this property belongs to the JDR. You will file an affidavit. You will produce the encumbrance certificate. You produce some documents showing that the property belongs to the JDR and there is no encumbrance on the property and it can be brought to sale. Beyond that, what is the verified statement? The verified statement is only to say that the property belongs to the JDR. It can be sold in execution. And an affidavit when it's filed is always a verified statement. Unless it's a verifying affidavit, every affidavit has to be verified, saying which portions are true to his personal knowledge, which portions are true to his belief, and if so, from where, which portions are based on legal advice which he believes to be correct. That is the format of the affidavit which has to be followed.
Right. So we have Ms. Purthi, limitation to file execution in decree of partition.
Decree of partition is a final decree, meets and bounds. If there are five people there, four people are partitioned, the remaining is your property.
Yes, sir.
No. If you have a partition suit, if there are four people in the partition suit, three people have demarcated the share and gone. What is left to be executed? What is left is your share, unless you say that is not the thing, in which case you have to raise an objection in the execution or whatever done by them, or file an execution. 47 say that the boundaries are not correct. Something like that has to be done.
We have Mr. Satyanarayan Gupta. Sir, I have
Yes.
We will have to unmute. Yes.
Yes, Mr. Satyanarayan Gupta. Namaskar.
Sir, you have muted again. You will have to unmute and quickly ask the question. Sir, mute maadkondidira. I have given you the option to unmute.
Unmute maadidare.
Sir, ega attachment before judgment in the original site.
Haudu.
Or attachment of property in an execution. The courts will not record the same in a one register. If a bona fide purchaser wants to buy the property, if he applies to the court to give me the attach whether this property is attached or not, he will not get the information. Is it not the lapse of the lapse on the part of the court to maintain the records with the property attached agide anta?
Sir, you and I have been in this profession for long. We have our own opinions. This may not be a place to discuss these matters, but what the court should do. Maybe it's a good idea that it's a good idea that the court keeps such a register. Yes, I agree with you.
There is a foreign F, but they don't record it.
Registered was letter bardo nale Satyanarayana Sahebru kettu bitre maartara.
Thank you
sir.
We have our secretary, Mr. Gangadhar. Yeah, he has a question. Yes, sir.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, ex parte ejectment decree. Challenged in miscellaneous proceedings.
Yes.
In the delivery of possession was also claims to be taken by the plaintiff in ex parte decree.
Yes.
In the execution proceedings. Miscellaneous petition was dismissed and matter went up in CRP. CRP reviewed the miscellaneous petition and execution proceedings materials attached by the bailiff in the premises of the defendant were thought to be kept in the place of the plaintiff, one room.
How do?
Now, if a plaintiff without safeguarding the property of the defendant, can
plaintiff will be liable if he has been, whoever is given custody.
Yes,
if you see, then if he is given custody, if you look at it, if he is given custody, then there is no, 1 minute, I'll just tell you this. 21. Custody, once they give custody, the person who has custody of the property has to take care, or else he'll be answerable for any damage to the property. See, and under Order 21, Rule 43.
Yes, yes.
Custodian, supposing the custodian cannot produce the property or there is damage to the property, 2143 says custodian will be liable for any loss or damage caused to it.
Even after the finality of the suit.
Whenever custody, unless he has been relieved of custody by any formal order, if he continues to be in custody, that's still your property, he becomes liable.
Yes, thank you very much, sir. It's very
welcome.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Parvati Nair has a question. Yes, quickly, ma'am.
Yes. Hi, sir. If the execution petition in which there is an order of attachment is dismissed, then application for restoration is filed and the execution petition has been restored. Does the order of the attachment revive, sir?
That means you are saying that execution was filed. In the execution, an order of attachment was filed and thereafter the execution for some reason got dismissed.
Yes.
Then you made an application to restore the execution and it was restored. Now you want to know whether the order of attachment is revived.
Exactly, sir.
No, I don't think so, because there is a 1982 judgment of the Calcutta High Court. I think it's on SEC Online.
Okay.
It's page 82, SEC Online, page 61 or 62, where the court has taken a view that once an execution petition has been revived, an earlier order of attachment will not be revived.
Okay. All right. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. N. Kumar has a question. Quickly, sir.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, your suit has been filed against a company, sir. Wherein the attachment of the debtor has been made, sir. Is it permissible, sir? The attachment before judgment of the debtor property has been done.
Now, if the basically it's a limited company, therefore liability is limited to the shares. However, it may be in that case that the director has signed a personal guarantee and is personally is undertaken the liability of the company, in which case the court has been approached and said that the directors and the liability of the director is coextensive with that of the company, and on those grounds they must have got attachment. Otherwise, courts generally don't grant attachment of properties of directors just because they are directors of a company. It's a limited life. If the court has done that, that is an order which has to be set aside.
Thank you, sir.
Ms. Akila has a question, but I see a gentleman there. Sir. Yes, sir.
Whether a bank account can be attached in execution proceedings, and if so, how, sir?
Bank account, these are known as garnishee proceedings. Judgment debtor is a garnishee. You have a decree against B. B has got an account with the bank, say C bank. You can make an application saying that C bank holds the money due to B. The court will pass an order. And in which case the court will pass the order and the court will tell the judgment debtor, listen, don't take the money from there. Court will tell the bank, don't pay the money. If you look at the order 21, rule 46, then 46A to I, all your answers will come in that.
Thank you, Mr. Rajshekar.
Yes, sir. My question is, whether contradictions in judgment and decree affecting the very executability of the decree, can those questions be gone into by the executing court?
If the, ultimately it's only the decree which is executable. So you are saying that there is contradiction between judgment and decree may not arise because I only go with
contradictions which are mutually destructive, affecting the very
executing court. If you actually see, we don't file the judgment. It's only the decree which is filed, which is the executable portion. If there is a contradiction and you file that thing, maybe an appeal should be filed to set aside the judgment and decree, saying that both are at variance with each other. The executing court cannot go into that. It only goes to the decree.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Chetan Chandrasekhar, yes, quickly.
Hi, sir. Sir, in a suit for eviction, where I have not asked for mean profit, if I get my decree for eviction and I file my execution 2 months later, by the time I actually get possession is 1 year later. Yes. Do I need to file a fresh suit for the mean profit or damages, or can I ask for it in my execution itself?
No. Execute, unless you have a decree, that means the debt to you is ascertained and fixed. There's no way the court is going to collect it for you. You will have to file a suit, get a decree, and then execute it again. Take possession, file one more suit, then execute it and take it again.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. We have Mr. Shivraj Baloli. Yes, sir.
Sir, good evening.
Good evening.
Sir, in a decree against conjugal, resolution of conjugal rights, what is the mode of executing such a decree?
Order 21, rule 32, either you arrest that guy or arrest her, or ask for attachment of property. That's the only way. Okay. You can't do much about restitution of conjugal rights. Only arrest of the person or attachment. Order 21, rule 32. If you see, you have all your answers.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Ms. Saraswati, quickly, you can pose your question. That would be our last question, offline and online.
Hello. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, ma'am.
Sir, in an execution petition, when it is pending and there is a Lok Adalat settlement, it will be done once for all. There is no appeal on that.
Tell Hello? Me. Yes.
Yeah, when the JDR again, if he is a defaulter, then what is the next option,
madam,
for us, sir?
Madam, you have a decree, you file execution, then it goes to the Lok Adalat. Lok Adalat, you try and settle. Yeah. The man doesn't settle. He doesn't You proceed with your execution.
Again, same procedure.
You continue with the execution. That's all.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Just continue with the execution. Don't worry about the Lok Adalat. Anyhow, a Lok Adalat order has executable as a decree of the civil court. You look at the Legal Services Authority Act or something. Then you take it forward in the execution.
Thank you very much, sir.
Welcome.
Sir, Mr. Rangarajan, yes.
Yes, Mr. Rangarajan.
Sir, you will have to unmute.
He has disappeared from the screen.
Shivat sir, namaskara.
Namaskara, namaskara, Rangarajan avare, namaskara.
Hey, Dira.
How are you? Long time.
Very long time.
Very long.
Today's discourse
on
perhaps a very important and a valuable subject has taken my memories back to some four and a half decades. See, it used to be said that the oaths of a degree holder starts really only after he obtains the degree.
Srinivas Anand also used to say that.
Yes. Number two, my seniors those days would say, look, the merit of a lawyer would be decided on how long you resist a degree validly passed, so that you use your brain from on complete order 21, so that you exhaust yourself and learn, because civil procedure is not that easy.
No.
At those days, in our golden days, the executions were fought like almost a sessions case.
Yes, correct.
Very, very kind of you for your wonderful discourse. Thank you very much.
Coming from you, I consider it a great compliment. Thank you, Mr. Rangarajan.
Thank you.
Sir, if you permit me, we have Mr. Vasant Kumar who has a question last.
Yes.
Yes, Mr. Vasant Kumar. Mr. Vasant Kumar, quickly, you will have to pose your question.
Sir.
Yes. Heli.
Sir, one question. Hello.
Heli.
Sir, ಈಗ ಕೇಸು ನಡೀತಾ ಇರ್ತದೆ, ಆ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾರಾಟ ಆಗ್ತದೆ, ಡಿಕ್ರಿ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ, ನಂತರ ಎಕ್ಸಿಕ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಆ ಡಿಕ್ರಿ ಆಗೋ ಬಿಫೋರ್ ಈ ನೇಚರ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಸೂಟ್ ಏನ್ ಅವರು ಶೆಡ್ಯೂಲ್ ಇದೆ, ಅದು ಅಗ್ರಿಕಲ್ಚರ್ ಟು ನಾನ್ ಅಗ್ರಿಕಲ್ಚರ್ ಆದಂತ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಡಿಕ್ರಿ ಹೆಂಗ್ ಮೇಂಟೈನಬಲ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ?
ಸರ್, ದಿ ಸೂಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಫೈಲ್ಡ್, ಓಕೆ. Suit, when the suit was filed, the property, yes, suit akavaga property, agricultural property, vyavasayada jameenu. Suit nadita iruvaga marata bikri aagibidutade, bikri aagi khareedarar en martare convert mark. You will have to treat it in the decree as you will have to treat it in the decree as agricultural land, because the sale is lease pendence and the property is to be maintained in the same condition as it was on the date of the suit. Lease pendence banbuttade, so you have to treat the decree as for agricultural land and enforce it like that. What the happens
position kottanta sandarbhadalli position, sir, one second. Look, position recovery aguvanta sandarbhadalli yaro hogi position ge koduvanta execution alli koduvanta sandarbhadalli property ne nature of the suit
You will have to make an application under 47 to the court to decide,
yes,
that
sir,
this the property in which respect of a, yes, decree was passed and the property in respect of which execution is sought, though it looks different, is the same property.
Yes, sir.
47 al arji akobodu.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Before we wind up the session, there's a peculiar question by Mr. Naveen Kumar offline. Sir, what, yes, is the remedy available when there is a fabrication in the decree by scratching the name of the word plaintiff in common interest?
File a criminal case. What? I mean, the executing court, and executing court will see the decree. If the executing court finds that there's fabrication, it and you show it that there is a fabrication, possibly the executing court will refer the matter to a magistrate. Or you will have to file some petition, because this, the question which has been asked is fabrication of a decree andre, that must be a certified copy which has got all the correct details. Actually, this fabrication may have occurred in the court office papers. Certified copy will contain the different name. Then what is it that the executing court can do? You'll have to go back there and have the decree amended to say that there is fabrication.
All right, sir. We are just now reaching the fag end of this session. on behalf of Advocates Association Bengaluru, sir, I extend my sincere thanks to you for presenting a wonderful webinar. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. It's been my pleasure.
Thank you, sir. With your permission, we'll be signing off the session, sir. Thank you, sir.
I will also sign off now. Good night.
Good night.